What do you see, Turtle?
I see a black screen that says offline.
No
Oh, I
way.
see us.
We're online?
Yeah.
All right, let me mute this call and run the intro video and we'll get going. Give me one sec.
Welcome to the Four Guys with Quarters show with your hosts Inferno, Assassin, and Clowns.
All right, everyone. Welcome to episode 71 of the Four Guys with Quarters podcast for December 30th, 2015, the last episode of 2015. So we'll kind of wrap up the year in news, maybe. Not really, actually. We're going to talk about a few things. We have a special guest today who I'll introduce in a minute. But before we get there, let me just say what we're going to be talking about today. We'll be talking about Ark Survival Evolved. You guys probably have heard of that, I'm guessing, if you're a video game fan. Right now, it is in game preview on the Xbox. So console exclusive for right now, I suppose. It's been on PC for a little while, probably since June. So we'll get a little bit into that, the Xbox version in particular, how we think that's going to pan out for Microsoft as a brand and as, you know, a new genre for the console generation. Then we'll talk about, you know, the future of, you know, Microsoft things like Games with Gold, the dashboard changing, that kind of stuff. Our favorite Xbox things of 2015, that kind of thing. So we'll kind of close it on that note. And then next year, next episode we have, we'll have a new layout and a new intro as well. So We'll see a few changes. Anyway, before I get started here, let's introduce our guest this evening. We have Tim Dog, Xbox enthusiast, Xbox community leader, big guy on Twitter, knows the Xbox peeps, talks with the inner circle, that kind of thing. And quite possibly the biggest Ark lover on planet Earth. So I felt it was appropriate to have him on, and Clowns got him on the show this week. So, Tim, welcome. Thanks for coming by.
Thank you guys for having me. I appreciate the offer. Pleasure to be here.
So we'll ask him a few questions before we get into all that other stuff, but we'll keep that brief so we can get into the nitty-gritty of the Ark Survival Evolved lovers that are here. Making his 71st straight appearance on our show, we have ZBCI Assassin.
Hi.
And we have Little Turtle Boy, who happens to be sitting further back in his chair this episode to get his full body into the into the frame. What's up, Turtle?
Hi.
And we have, last but not least, Italian Clowns. What's up, man?
Hey, what's going on?
And I am Inferno 217, as always. I say as always, but I've actually missed a few episodes, so I probably shouldn't say that. Anyway, let's give a shout out to our sponsor before we get going here, MoviePass.com. I don't know if you've ever heard of this, Tim Dog, but MoviePass.com gets you unlimited movies. If you pay $30 a month, you can go to 93% of nationwide theaters. You know, works at Regal, Showcase, AMC, that kind of stuff. Even smaller theaters in your area as well, if you're in the U.S. Cool. And you can watch a movie a day, so like 30 movies a month for $30 if you want, or, you know, whatever, go see one a week or two a week. You know, around here in Boston, one a week, this is definitely worth it. So I have it myself, but you guys don't have to pay any money if you go to fourguyswithquarters.com. You can sign up for a free 2-week trial that helps our site, even if you cancel the trial. So please do go to our site, sign up for the free 2-week trial. You can go see 14 movies and cancel it if you'd like, or you can see 14 movies and keep it and enjoy unlimited movies nationwide. So yeah, have you heard about that before, Tim?
That's no, that's very cool. I would definitely. I like movies, so I'm actually going to see Hunger Games tomorrow.
Nice.
So yeah, no, that is a great deal. You figure, if you do that, if you go to movies, which I can probably go once a month, probably.
Yeah.
You buy that, you're set. You know what I mean?
Exactly. Yep. I see with this thing, I'm seeing way more movies than I ever would have. I will admit that, but I still like being able to just walk in, get my tickets and know that, I don't have to pay ridiculous money to see like Paul Blart Mall Cop 2 or something stupid like that.
Is there restrictions or like
New run movies? You could see Jurassic World. I saw the day it came out, actually the day before it came out. I saw the early runs on the Thursday. Star Wars, people were using it in my theater and that kind
that's
of thing.
Very cool.
So
it really is. You could beat the system. That's like EA Access. It's like it's a way to beat the system, which is if you go to the movies, like I go, I love the movies. I go by myself. My wife doesn't want to go with me. She says movie theaters are dirty, so whatever. but I go and I love just I went as a kid with my father and I always remember that. And I just there's something about watching a movie still to this day at the theater compared to watching it at home. You still don't get the full effect.
You
get the full effect at a movie theater.
Definitely. 100% agree. And with all the new technology, with the reclining seats and all this stuff they're putting in theaters now, it's like a friggin' spa, for Christ's sake. Might as well just go. Really? So, that's moviepass.com. People, go check it out on our site. 2-week free trial. All right. Well, Tim, tell us, who you are and why you're so important in the Xbox community and why everyone knows you and why you talk to, Phil Spencer and all them.
I go on Twitter. I started Twitter basically I was infuriated by NeoGAF and Thuway was on Twitter, and I actually started tweeting him during the first start of this. But, at that point it was just a joke and, I didn't really take it seriously. And then I transitioned into, just being this insane fanboy that was just everyone knew I would say crazy things. I wouldn't really take it seriously. Then I started taking it seriously. I'm there every day for Xbox. I talk about, my feelings about what I think. I'm always looking with the community to make Xbox better. And I feel that now, as the longer time I've been doing it, you're making a little increments of impact where, it just happens, I guess, whatever. I guess I could be funny at times and I can joke around a lot. So, they took a liking to me. I became friends with Aaron. And then Phil actually had me blocked. And then Pinello told me this story at E3. He said, you have to look at this guy's Twitter. He says, you just please unblock him.
Oh, wow.
So the story goes. So then I made friends with Phil and, I didn't show that I was that crazy fanboy anymore. I took it more seriously. Mm-hmm. And, he reads my stuff. I read his stuff. It's the nature of Twitter that's great. And he's been – him and his whole team have really embraced the community. And they know everyone in the community, whether they – they know, Aaron knows everyone. Aaron's the number one guy. He knows. He started this interaction, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And it's just growing, and it grew. And that's where I am. Otherwise, I'm just an average Joe, works, comes home and wants to play Ark or play Halo or whatever. Mm-hmm. I love video games. Grew up with video games. I remember my father always hated video games. So maybe that was something that I always remember, but I loved it. I bought my own consoles myself, because they were always expensive. And here I am now. I went with it, and I love video games. And I'm 39 now, and I'm loving video games and the community and everything that's going on. Things like this podcast and the steps that we're making as a whole as an industry, as the community, as just the genre of video games. It's a special time, in my opinion, and it's getting to be even stronger. So that's basically what I, you know, what I'm about, what I like about everything, and why I'm so interested. I've been on wonderful podcasts. This podcast looks like it's excellent.
Thank you.
This is the first time I've seen it or been on it. Partly because I'm on a lot of podcasts, but it's very good. You guys have a lot, I think, going for you, or you know, potential there. So just keep it up, and that's it. You know, that's me. You can follow me at Twitter. Just search Twitter and put Tim Space Dog.
There you go. That's where to find him, everybody. And if you want to see where to find him on Twitch and Xbox as well, and you're watching the video version, look underneath his picture up there in the top left corner, and it has his Twitter handle and his Xbox gamer tag and all that kind of stuff. So follow him on there, especially if you want to get into some ARK, because this guy plays that all the time. So,
too much.
Man, we got a lot of questions for you already, Tim. Do the other guys mind if I take the questions from the chat before you guys ask questions?
Sure, all right.
Power of the China. What's up, China? She says, thoughts on the new dashboard, while new to most of us. So I'm sure you're in the preview program, obviously. Yeah. So you've been with the new dashboard for a while. Tell us what you think of it, you know, compared to
the current state. I like it much more than the older one. It was too confusing. I feel that this UI is almost there. I think the next couple of updates, you'll really start to see it shine. But overall, I like it just because it's simple to make chat with friends. And, you know, just you hit the right analog stick and you're right there for the things that I do.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, I check out the whole UI, but those two things are very important to me. A right trigger, right to games and apps. Those two things are huge. There's still things that need to be put in there, and I've been vocal about Xbox, find a code or whatever that go. What is it? What is
user
it
when code.
You user Xbox code user, yeah. needs to be on the dashboard centrally located, because too many people still look for that and don't know what the hell's going on, and it's 3 minutes, and then they get frustrated, especially new users. I've even found myself at times. I have Kinect, but everyone doesn't have Kinect.
Exactly. Yeah.
But it's much better. I feel like it's more fluid. It's trying to do a lot of things. I think they could help a little do better with the graphics. But overall, I'm looking forward to Cortana, which is going to be really, hopefully, I have high aspirations, and see what happens. Just overall, I think it's just, you know, the software team's so good that they're just going to, you know, when they're not making something, they're going to keep honing the system. So overall, it's a good starting point.
Other guys, what do the other guys think about the new dashboard versus the old one? Quickly, anyone?
I like it a lot. I have to say that it runs smoother. It's faster.
It's definitely faster.
I think the old dashboard was very confusing, and when you came from 360 to the old dashboard on Xbox One, you kind of felt like, what's going on? And Microsoft listened to their fans and their community, and they coming out with something better, and this is it, and we're getting there.
Definitely agreed, 100%. Turtle or Assassin, anything to say about the new one? No?
It definitely still has its glitches.
Yeah, for sure. And look out for February update. They've already said that in February we're going to get a little bit of a mini overhaul that should fix a lot of the issues that people are complaining about. So, and that's the thing, you know, the next question kind of addresses it. Actually, Assassin, you want to throw in anything really quick about the new dashboard?
I love the, you know, the fastness and other stuff, but I mean, there's bugs.
Yeah.
Like Turtle said.
And kind of throwing it to the next question we have in chat, it kind of is a good segue that we talked about the bugs and you know, Microsoft listening to the community and stuff. Oh my God, or OMG, it's James Play in the chat. Tim says, he's a PS4/PC fanboy, but out of interest, what is the plan to beat PlayStation? And, you know, I don't want to influence your answer or anything, but I think, you know, the fact that you know, Microsoft is taking so much feedback from people and making it happen and stuff like the dashboard and making it better. I think that's, you know, in those top bullet points for what is making them win out some of the, you know, later sales numbers that we've been seeing, because people trust Microsoft now, trust them, and think that they're actually, you know, wanting to help the consumer.
So that's excellently put. I think that's what they're doing here. I've talked to Phil, and he talks exactly what you said. He said, I talked to him in DMs, and he said one time to me, he says, it's about building trust with the community. Right now, we're not right there, but we have to build trust, and that's the main thing. And that's, you know, you said it great right there. But personally, my opinion on what they have to do to compete with Sony is, I've been thinking about this a lot lately. Sony right now is going to probably outsell the PS2. This is going to probably be the all-time selling console. So they're going up against lofty competition. Mm-hmm. The only thing I can see them doing is winning possibly North America, which is NPDs. But it's right now, it's for this generation, it's going to be tough. Mm-hmm. But my opinion, what they should do is, I talked a little bit about it last night on Twitter. I think that they need to stop with being, you know, they have a reputation department that, you know, monitors everything, and they're afraid to strut their stuff in a way because they're afraid PR department will coming down on them. They can't really speak as freely as they used to when Matrick was around. Like, Matrick was like a bold guy. He would say things, and they would show bravado. This is like a complete opposite. So where I think Matrick have been too much, I do think that Microsoft needs to move away from that. They need to support sites, do what Sony does with like IGN and GameStop. They support them. They throw money at them. They throw merchandise at them. They throw consoles. You know, there's a way to get yourself in the goodwill of the media, in my opinion, where I feel the media is like completely right now stacked against them. Whether that will influence sales, I think it does to some extent, but overall, I think that they need to support podcasts like your own and other podcasts in the community, have their people talk on shows. They need to get out there. They need to, you know, they need to keep doing what they're doing, basically, building up the trust. I wouldn't be surprised if we see backwards compatibility for OG Xbox some way, somehow. I know that they're working on it. Their problem supposedly is through the achievements, which I don't know how you put in a disc and then have achievement. I mean, so it might not happen, but they're trying. They're trying, and I think they're on the right track.
I wanted to jump in, Tim, and just add on to what you said, if you don't mind. I'm not sure if you were done.
Yeah, no, I'm done. I was right as you came in.
Yeah, I felt bad because I heard you saying something there. But I just, you know, I think when the Xbox One launched, I think the European media really gave it bad press because they really hyped up all these conspiracy theories and all these fear factors, whereas like the PS4 didn't get the same kind of treatment from the European media and was looked at more like a hero, like a anti, you know, conspiracy machine, and they weren't going to do this
for
or
the
that.
Gamers.
Yeah. Yes. And you know, going back to that, if anybody actually ever read the terms of agreement on a PS3 when Geohot Jill broke the PS3, after his first break in the PS3 from Fail Overflow, Sony actually added a rootkit, and in the terms of agreement, it says they can monitor your system. So what everyone was afraid from the Xbox One, Sony has been doing since the PS3. And I just think the Xbox One got the bad rap, and I think the launch team didn't really market it properly. Mm-hmm. And now that we got a great team at Xbox leading it, like Phil and Aaron Greenberg, they're doing a fabulous job, and they're listening to the community, the fans, they're listening to the devs, and they're getting this thing out there. And we're still hurting, like, you know, in the European markets and the Asian markets because of all that. But I think over time, if North America adapts more to the Xbox phone, I think we'll see it more successful everywhere else as well.
Good point. It's excellent.
Kind of what we were just saying, and kind of what we were saying that Microsoft has already done. Good point in the chat, OMG, it's James Play, says, to him, Xbox needs to stop fighting against PlayStation, just focus on the Xbox fan base and community. And I don't know if you saw this, James Play, but Phil Spencer actually, in an interview, said recently, and by recently, I mean probably a couple months ago, said that the focus is no longer fighting against PlayStation. That's that they don't want to make it as much of a console war as they do of, you know, let's win people over with our games and then support the people that we already have in a unique way that makes us stand out as... you know, philanthropic in a way, you know, kind of like I want to make sure that our babies are handled, our babies are coddled, but if you want to jump in and be our new babies, then you'll be coddled as well, that kind of deal. Not so much as, you know, PlayStation sucks, or I don't know how old you are, James Play, but back in the day with Super Nintendo and Genesis, when they were like, Genesis does what Nintendo don't, or whatever that, and all these ads about like how bad the other companies were. You know, I don't think Microsoft's about that anymore. I think they've kind of shifted focus a little bit. Let's see. Anything else about what Microsoft has to do, Turtle or Assassin? No.
I guess while we're on that, something else I want to throw out there too.
Yeah.
Is I think Windows 10 being like one of the most successful operating systems with the free upgrade and being almost on every PC out there, and their intentions with Windows 10 and crossplay with Xbox One.
Mm-hmm.
That is amazing, and that is fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you got PC fans that you know for years that will never get over to the console, they're gonna see you playing the console and say, hey, let's get a cross game. So I think Microsoft's in the right direction, and Sony will never have the power to do something like that because they don't have their own OS. They use FreeBSD. So it's never going to happen for Sony, but it's going to happen for Microsoft.
Right, right.
And it's already great because, like, just the other night, like, my cousin doesn't own an Xbox One, but I was able to party chat with him while I was on my Xbox. And he was on the Xbox app on Windows 10.
Right. Wow. I mean, I knew obviously that works. We've done that before, but that's like the first time I've ever heard of like somebody without an Xbox actually using it to communicate with console players. I think that's really cool. Your cousin's a PlayStation gamer, right, Turtle, if I remember correctly?
Yeah.
So. What else? More questions in the chat for Tim Dog before we get to ARG. J Street wants to know, what was it like to meet Phil Spencer for the first time, and what was that first conversation about? Like a brief summary of that, if you can.
Well, it was at Xbox Fan Fest. I was hanging out with South, and we were kind of, you know, back from the crowd. You know, Major Nelson was up front, so most people were there. So we were just holding back, and here comes Aaron. I mean, they just came from they were dropped off by a kid. They just came from a big dinner.
Yeah.
And they came. It was like Aaron, Kudo. It was Kareem, was one of the head guys in the technology department.
Mm-hmm.
It was Yabara. It was just like they came up in a rush. And then Phil was coming, and I was like, holy shit, here's Phil. And I didn't know what to say to him. So they stopped, and they said hi to South, and I was just kind of hanging back. Then Aaron's like, this is Tim Dog. And like Phil, you know, he was introduced, and I met Mike Nichols, and he's like, yeah, you know, I was like, whatever. Really, like, you're Tim Dog. So it was all going on that. And like Phil then there were just people were talking, and I kind of made a little joke to Phil, and I said something, and he laughed, and I shook his hand and said, how you doing, Phil? But we didn't really talk that, because it was like they were like we got to go over here to meet the fans. So I said all right. And then later on, then we talked. South was great. He was making jokes and stuff, and Phil just is a great guy. He's just really just a cool dude. Just like a nice guy. Besides what he does, this is a person pretending he never worked at Xbox. He's just a nice, funny person. He has a good sense of humor. He's always laughing. Yeah. He made a joke about Silent Hill. Two billion. Aaron looked at me and laughed, meaning that like the series, like, oh, you know, he made an offhanded joke, making fun of the rumor, basically.
Right, right.
So you know, that was it. Then we took pictures, and then you know, just you know, we just kept, you know, talking. And I would consider my friend, because he's obviously we're acquaintances, I think, as you would say. But
yeah.
You know, he's a type of person that you know, he likes me, I like him, and he likes a lot of people in the community. Mm-hmm. But I consider him a really good person, though. I'm interested in you know, when he talks and what his plans are. He doesn't tell me anything. He won't, like, you know, he's very, I know not to ask about certain
stuff.
Sure,
yeah, of course. You know?
Yeah. But it was a good experience. And I'm looking forward to be hanging out in L.A. this 14th to the 16th this year. I'm scheduling it. So
nice. Yeah. You know, I think that last point that you made about, you know, him being, you know, you feeling like his friend, even though, like, you know, he has a million friends, right? And, yeah. It's like, but I mean, I think that says something about, you know, the people's, you know, how approachable the, yeah, Xbox as a brand is, and having him as the leader, because I think that says a big, well, at least in North America, it does. I think having him step in for Matrick, you know, as good or bad as people think Matrick was, I think having him step in, turn the franchise around, I mean, that's well documented, but I think it doesn't have to do 100% like what you said with his leadership. It has to do with, you know, the kind of person he is and the approachability, right, he has. And, you know, everybody thinks, hey, you know, this guy is one of us up there, you know, running this thing, and we're going to get what we want, right, and he knows what we want, kind of deal, because he's one of us. He's one of our boys, you know. So, yeah, big thing that Phil Spencer took over. I didn't even think Matrick was that bad of a guy, but, I mean, some of the things he was saying was definitely sending the brand down south there at the launch, you know.
Yeah.
With the troops and everything. If you don't have the internet, if you don't have the internet, then go get a 360.
Kind that was of, the I mean, worst come one. On. That was just like, oh no,
dude. I had a facepalm on that one when I saw that. I was like, damn, we're screwed. Xbox people are screwed. What else? Maybe one more question, and then we'll get to Ark. OMG, as James Play wants to know, is Xbox ever going to get COD DLC first again? I don't even know if Tim will know anything about that, but I'll ask the question. Do you know anything about that?
Doubtful.
Probably doubtful, yeah.
They outsold, looks like they outsold, or very close to it. I mean, it was packaged in with PlayStation 4, but if you look, you know, and things that I've heard, they've done really well with COD, despite the marketing deal. That was the real killer of this holiday, from what I heard, was the Battlefront was made on an insane amount of buzz, and they look at that money, I'm pretty sure, and say, let's just put that towards Banjo or Battletoads, or for, there's no reason, really, in my opinion, and from what I've gathered, because of the money that they're being talked about, with COD, that they you know, have anything to worry about, because the fan base, we love shooters on Xbox,
of course. Yeah,
we might not buy a game like Sunset Overdrive, which is kind of depressing. If it's a good shooter, you know, you better bet your bottom dollar a lot of people probably will get it on the PS4, the people that are rich, but they'll also get it on the Xbox One. It's just, you know, with the controller, with the Elite, the, you know, everything that goes with COD. I think Xbox kind of got out of that deal, and that might have been a positive. The Star Wars was the real one that pushed the win for MPD in November.
Right, right.
I just want to throw it out there that I would love to see another unique game like Sunset Overdrive.
Me too.
Yeah, Tim.
I don't understand that one, but, you know.
Yeah, Tim Dog. If you're right about them, you know, the way you kind of say it is that like Microsoft was kind of more or less, Microsoft didn't necessarily lose it 100%. They kind of like wanted to allocate their money differently in terms of paying Activision a boatload of money.
$55 million.
Yeah. So I mean, so if you're right about that, you know, Microsoft saving some money to make some new IPs or like put it towards, you know, a new installment in a beloved franchise like Banjo, like I'm all for that 100%. You know, I would accept that any day of the week. Yeah. I'm not a huge COD guy though, but I mean, if, even if I were, I'd be like, you know what? Fine. It's the same thing. Like 1 month exclusivity or a brand new awesome IP. Like, come on. Choice is easy.
Yeah, exactly. I think Phil has been on paper saying just that too. He says he wants to, I think that it was a blessing in disguise when with the COD. I do think that Xbox does have a budget and they don't, you know, they're not the same entity where Microsoft will just throw money at it. I think Satya runs it more like a business. Like, you know, if you're going to spend, we're not just going to give you $400 million just because we can for marketing. You have to run this like you're running a business. And I think Microsoft is adjusting to that right now. But I do think that it's possible, especially with quarter one results, if they do show a really, which I think they're going to show very good returns on Xbox, that they might get the purse strings opened up. Now, say like Satya says you can have $40 million, and now he is on the table, COD and get COD back, because I think that Activision will do anything, and I think Sony right now is probably locked in this, but they'll still take it, but they're not super, it's not the biggest thing for them, put it that way. Where they have $40 million, you could put it towards the marketing deal, get the DLC, or get a new Perfect Dark. The Unreal Engine. Maybe an actress, like they're doing with Quantum Break, like stuff like that just opens up the ideas, you know what I mean? Which, if you look at it, why wouldn't you take the IP? But there is something to be said for third-party support, because it's very powerful.
Right. And it's not like the third-party, it's not like that Activision doesn't support Microsoft. I mean, obviously, Destiny exclusivity, COD, time exclusivity, all that kind of stuff. But I understand that people would see it, as that they're losing a big third-party publisher. But, I mean, those games are still out on Xbox and still do well for Activision. They'd be fools to make them exclusive to Sony. So, people don't be scared that they're going to lose Activision as a publisher. It's not like the Sega Saturn and EA or anything. They're not gonna lose Activision. It's just that, Sony's got more money to throw at, advertising deals like Tim Dog said, and Microsoft wants to be more frugal about it and make some new stuff. So,
but I mean, at the same time, we can't forget that Sony sold off a lot of their own divisions just to support the PS4.
Right, exactly. Yeah, so yeah, Sony's losing a lot of their computer division. See you later. Vio Computers, gone. And, Sony may be doing well with the PlayStation front, and people may view them as as in the black, but in reality, they've lost a lot of their divisions that they once dominated in. And, are they doing that to support the console division now? Is that definitely what they're doing? Who knows, but in reality, Sony as a company is not doing super well. They're just doing well in the console division.
They're doing much. They allocated a lot of losses with those pay. Like when they sold off SOE and they did all those moves. That was my opinion with Sony is that they are throwing a lot of money at advertising. There's no doubt about it. They're throwing more money than Xbox because, one, they have a bigger, they're getting more money, they're getting more revenue, and there's a misnomer that Sony is broke and they don't have money. They have money and they're spending it on PlayStation
4. Right.
Yeah. Yep. The big thing for them though is if I were in their position, I would have just doubled down on the console business. I do think now they have a VR, which is a wild card. It's either going to be connect like, or it's gonna, you know, be have felt resistance. You know, that's probably for another show, but
right.
You know, you know, it's depends on, you know, they are spending, especially with VR on subject, they are spending a ton of money just all over the place.
Right.
You know, real quick, Tim, you remember the best VR that ever came out was Virtual Boy?
Virtual Boy, yeah. Oh yeah.
I just want to
I knew you were going with that.
The all red,
baby. If you don't have a desk, you can't play it.
Yep.
wow, clowns, honestly. There's actually a question in the chat for all of us, and Tim included, so I want to take it. And J Street kind of alluded to it earlier as well. What would we change? I guess everybody can answer this in order or something. What would we change about the Xbox One if we could change one thing about Xbox One and one thing about PS4? If we could change anything we wanted, the family dogs wants to know, as well as J Street, what's one thing that we can change? Why doesn't Assassin go first since he hasn't been talking a lot?
Come back to me. I'm thinking.
Oh Jesus, man.
he defers.
All right, Turtle, do you have an answer?
For the Xbox, I would really like to stop listening.
Oh Jesus, man! We're doing a podcast here. Can you turn that thing off, please?
Okay, if I could change one thing about you know what,
nice.
It would be I would want simultaneous downloads.
Simultaneous downloads like the PlayStation?
Yeah, and for PS4, I would like better sorting of my game library.
Oh my god, yep, that was going to be mine. For PlayStation 4, the game library is a mess. I mean, the dashboard is not the greatest, but the sorting of the library is a mess. Why not just put a list? I mean, Sony, if you're going to do it like that, just put a list for God's sakes. Like, oh man, that is the one thing I hate about the PlayStation 4. If I haven't used it recently, it's not on my XMB bar or whatever you want to call it, and I have to go into the library to get to it. Oh, and I just put in a 2 terabyte hard drive as well, so I'm gonna be filling that thing on my PlayStation, and I feel like it's just gonna be a mess, like scrolling down. Ugh, don't even get me started. One thing I would change about the Xbox. I might have another answer for software in a minute, but I want to say physically the thing is a tank, and the power brick is as well. I can't get a picture of my entertainment unit right now for the video version, but if I could, it would show you that it's a mess because that brick in the Xbox One are just so massive. So physically, that's what I'd change about it, but software, I'll get my answer in after you guys. Anyone else? Clowns? Tim? Anybody?
I would probably change the design, even though it's okay. I would change the design for the Xbox so you can stand it up laterally and you can stand it up sitting down like the PlayStation 4. Mm-hmm. And the PlayStation 4, I would like an Elite controller with it or an option for that because I do not like I don't mind the stick layout, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people have problems with that. I don't mind it. I actually sometimes prefer it. Like,
oh, yeah,
it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just the controller life is just I don't know if I had a bad controller. So it was like really ridiculous
on the PS4.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. No, the battery life sucks. It does. No. It sucks for everyone. It's not good. Assassin. I remember when because I didn't have a PlayStation 4 at launch. I just got one this year actually. And Assassin was telling me about the PlayStation 4 and he was like, oh, my battery's already dead in my controller. I'm like, dude, there's no way, because if you have the play and charge kit on the Xbox One, when you first get that thing, the first charge lasts for like 20 something hours.
True.
And it's just crazy. Like, holy Jesus, this thing lasts so long. And, in one day of chatting with Assassin, he's like, oh, gotta charge my controller. Oh, battery's dead. And I'm just like, are you serious? How can it be so dead?
I had sold my controller because I have to get another controller to really, because mine was like ridiculously bad. I mean, like, it didn't seem normal. Like, so I have to get another controller. Mm-hmm. I do think that, you know, if it does have, I don't think it is, but I mean, there could have been a problem with mine. I mean, it was just so, I couldn't believe how bad it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no. I mean, if normally I get like Assassin, I don't know if you have the same experience, or if all you guys, you all have a PS4 now. Like 6 or 7 hours, I think, is the best I've ever gotten on my PS4 controller.
I've went at least a week.
Dude, okay. Turtle's a PS4 fanboy, Tim. Just let me know. Dude, there's no way you got a week. Those controllers die so quickly.
Yeah. Yeah,
Turtle. How long did you get, Assassin? How long did you get on yours? Longest.
While I was on?
Seven?
Well, I've had mine without plugged in for a few months because I don't play it. Okay. But Jesus, probably, man, maybe like 5 hours at the top.
Yeah.
Okay, mine may have been an exaggeration, but I've had mine stay charged way longer than 5 hours.
Yeah, I'd say like seven probably was the longest I've had it. Clowns, anything to say about the controller
battery? No, not about the controller, but real quick, just to go back to what I change and...
Oh, yeah, what, absolutely, yeah.
For the Xbox One, because Microsoft pretty much has all the agreements with PC vendors and PC manufacturers, I would, if I was Phil or somebody up there, I would start making deals with them in the Generation 2 Xbox One or Generation 3 Xbox One. I would put in slide-in trays to expand the RAM. Like, you know, if a new game comes out and requires more RAM, the ability to upgrade it just like a PC, but with slide-in trays for users, because it'd be so easy for someone just to slide in a tray.
Interesting.
Maybe a PC chip as well, like a CPU. Things like that, just so that it can expand and overtake the Steam Box. And for software on the Xbox One, what I'd be looking at, since Windows 10 dominates the market and Steam uses primarily Windows 10 over Linux, I would make deals with Steam and be like, listen, on our Gen 2 or Gen 3 Xbox Ones, we can incorporate like a maybe like a semi-Steam library. Let's make a contract together, since all your stuff runs on Windows 10. And let's make a contract so that Xbox gamers can play Xbox games and some Steam games as well. That's mm-hmm. what I would do. PS4, I would make it come with stands for a paperweight. No, I'm just kidding.
Wow, Jesus.
a better UI system. I mean, yep. it's pretty bad.
Definitely. All right, Assassin, we're back to you, big guy.
All right. For the Xbox One, you might think I'm crazy, but more USB ports.
No, I agree with you on that.
And another HDMI thing, so I can plug my PS4 into my Xbox.
You're ridiculous. Okay, go ahead.
And then the PlayStation. Just
maybe a water float for the PS4 so you could just throw it around. No, I'm just kidding.
More first-party games.
Definitely. I think 2016 is probably going to be the year that PlayStation finally like wakes up and releases their first party stuff. I mean, we already know that there's a few games that they're gonna come out with. So, it only took them like 2.5 years to realize that, though. But yeah. All right, so that's I think that's gonna be it for questions from the chat, since we've already gone like 40 minutes on this topic on the question answer session. Before we get to ARK, let's just throw in one of the topics that I had here, because we've already been talking about it, with the future of Xbox and what we think could be improved and all that. What do you think about games with gold versus like deals with gold? What do you think the future of that is, Tim? Because I know like that kind of started as a baby idea. I'm not even sure if Microsoft wanted to continue it for this long, to be honest with you, but it seems like they've kind of evolved it to include more games, and they're taking people's feedback and stuff like that. So what do you think the future of that is? Do you think they're going to change that up a lot, or do you think they're just going to keep it the same, or what do you think about that program?
Games of Gold?
Yeah, or Deals with Gold, either one. Yeah.
Well, Deals with Gold, I think they need to do a little bit better. They're doing fine with it, but they're not on Steam's level. But I think that will improve. With Games with Gold, what I do see them doing is just really showering you with, you know, big games. Not big game. Like, you'll have two indies, and you might have, you know, obviously two 360 games. And if they could do the emulation for OG Xbox, you'd see two of them too, where there might be game, you know, they're working on a solution for multi-disc games. They're just going to try to shower you with games, which is smart. You know, OG emulation would be pretty cool, because now you could have six games or like five games. So I think that's where they're heading. I don't think that you're going to see too much, you know, AAAs on the Xbox One level. They don't really seem to do that. They'll do it, you know.
Not even like Rise, Son of Rome or anything like that.
Everyone, like, I mean, just get Rise. Everyone wants Rise. I don't know what it is, but it's the most asked about, and I agree, it should be there.
Yeah.
When they do, that'll make a lot of people
really happy. I'll be stoked, man. Yeah. I'll be stoked.
So that's the way I see it evolving, just more content.
You know, along with Rise, like also maybe Dead Rising 3 or something.
Yeah, some of the launch titles that, you know, are exclusive to Xbox One. I think it would be nice to see some of those. You know, Rise and Dead Rising would be an incredible start. I think that would be awesome.
Forza 5.
I don't know why they don't do that. I don't know if it's licensing. Like, why would they have Rise?
Right. I mean, you know, Rise, you either love hate or hate Rise. You know, it didn't. Some people gave it great reviews. Some people put it in the dumpster kind of deal. But
visually, like, it's good for 10 minutes for anybody. Right. You know, looking at that.
Oh, yeah.
Like, so I agree. I think it's something that they should definitely do.
Yeah, I gotta say, I didn't really get sucked into the story, but I spent a lot of time in the arena.
Oh, yeah, dude. It was fun. A lot of fun. I would go back and play that again. 100%. And if the multiplayer ever caught up again, like co-op in that again, I would do that in a heartbeat. And I think a lot of people would. I think a lot of people who got Xboxes, you know, this Christmas and even last Christmas don't even know what the hell that game is. So
such a, like, I don't think it was a great game. I thought I gave it a 7.5. I remember, like, my personal opinion. I finished it, but that is a freaking strong IP. Like, I don't, like, if they could have had Rise 2, I'd be really hyped for Rise 2.
Oh yeah,
just because I liked the engine, I felt like it needed more work. I felt graphically it was just still to this day. And I can be a graphics whore a little, so just, you know, I put up with that game, you know, the repetitiveness and stuff like that, the nature of it, that, you know, the qualms that people had, I put up with it. I definitely saw it, but I just, because it looked so good, and I felt like it had a lot more potential, and it was a good shot for a nice new IP, but it didn't take off.
Right, unfortunately. And it kind of sucks that it didn't, and I'm kind of actually surprised it didn't, because they put so much advertising into it, and they showed it off, you know, at E3s and stuff when, you know, they demoed, or at their event when they demoed the console, not E3, their own event.
That game got such crazy hate. I don't understand it. It just got such crazy hate. I remember reading, and I explained to him earlier about how, like, that was the stuff that was going on. I mean, they just, you look at some of the threads on NeoGAF with that. Just obliterating the game. They wouldn't give it a shot. And it influenced the media, I feel, a little bit. And the game definitely was lower scored than it should have been.
Oh, for sure.
I felt like it was really a game. That was, they were the wrong place at the wrong time, Crytek. The engine is, like I said, I would love to see that engine again. And I think it's dead. I don't think you'll ever see that engine again. And that might have been the best Xbox engine that ran on Xbox. I mean, sure, it had its dips and stuff, but wow, like, that's next generation graphics.
Agreed.
You know?
Definitely. Yeah, and if Rise 2 came out, I'd be first in line.
Yeah, it would be crazy.
First in line, I would be there, but it's not going to happen, unfortunately. God damn it. Anything else from the other guys about the future of Games of Gold or Deals of Gold or anything you want to see before we go to ARK for 20 minutes?
I think that Deals of Gold do need, it might, they do need to be more competitive with that.
Oh, yeah, for sure. It's not even, I don't even think that they need to be necessarily more competitive all the time, because sometimes you look at the deals, you're like, whoa, these are awesome. And then, like, the very next week, you're like, what the hell are these? Like, these are shit.
I mean, it's not like how, you know, like some people, whenever they announce Games with Gold for the month, they're like, everyone says, like, people say this sucks because, like, you know, you already have the games. Like, some people have those games.
Yep.
But with Deals with Gold, like, it's not even about something like that. You can look at one game and see it for, like, maybe, like, $40 or whatever, and they like go on PC and it's like 20 or 15.
Sure, yeah, yep. You know, and that's like the trend now. PC games are just so much, the same games are just so much cheaper on PC than Xbox, and in a lot of times, or on PlayStation as well, just console in general. And then a lot of times, the PlayStation, the PC versions are superior. And you're just like, I'm paying more for less of a game just because I'm playing on a console, but. You know,
I mean, lately, Xbox Deals with Gold and the PlayStation Plus or PlayStation in general, like, their discounts have been pretty much the same.
Right, right.
You know, like, whenever Xbox had Need for Speed for $24, it was $24 on PlayStation.
And Sony as well. And yep.
Battlefront was also $40 on both.
Yep. No, I agree. And that's when you say more competitive, I agree with you on that, because they need to be more competitive to differentiate themselves. You know.
Like, if, like, you know, I'm not a person that, like, cares for achievements. Like, I play the game for the game, which is, like, known between, like, all of us guys.
Yeah.
But I'm like, if I see a single-player game cheaper on PC and I can run it on my PC, I have a gaming PC. It's like, if I can get it cheaper there, why would I get it on console?
Mm-hmm. Yep. No, a lot of people are probably thinking the same thing, man. A lot of people do have a gaming PC they can play with, and, you know, just pick one over the other because they can just get it cheaper and it performs better, so... Yeah, so competitive in that nature, I agree with you there. I definitely agree with you there. Just quickly from the chat, the Family Doug says, Games of Gold rarely has games he likes on it. Wish they would have better games twice in a blue moon. And also, he says, Deals of Gold has a lot of good deals on it all the time. See, I feel like maybe Deals of Gold has one good deal, you know, every week maybe. But, like, I feel like there are a lot of weeks where there's a lull. And you're just like, what the hell am I getting here? But Games with Gold, you know, we kind of talked about throwing in, like, the Rise Sons of Rome or Son of Rome or, like, Dead Rising or something like that. I think people would rather see that than get, like, a free brand new game, even though people are like, and even though it's brand new, you know, like Volgar the Viking or Chariot or, what else? Can't think of one at the top of my head, but brand new games that are free. Night Squad or whatever it was, that Bomberman one. That kind of thing. Like, people aren't excited about getting a brand new game for free. They would be more excited to get an established older game for free than a brand new game for free, which is crazy to me in some regard. But I see where a lot of people are coming from there, and I think, you know, I don't know. Maybe Microsoft will deliver. I don't know. I'm not sure.
Make Ark. Imagine if Ark came for gold. That would blow people's minds.
Oh, wow.
You know how many consoles that would sell?
That would blow people's minds, man. Yeah, you're right. That's a move that they could make, but it would probably cost a lot of money, but
right.
I would do it. I mean, I think it could sell the system a bit.
Yep.
Speaking of Ark, we're finally to that point in the conversation here. So needless to say, it's a huge friggin' hit. 1 million plus downloads already in game preview, which is unbelievable. success for a game that I'm just going to say it, I don't think is really that great in its current state. I mean, I think it will be great. It will be great. There's no doubting that. I mean, it has all the elements that anyone could even want. I can't even think of something else that you could add in. Like, it doesn't have robots like that. Like, it would be silly shit like that. But, like, I think it has a lot of good things going for it, but in its current state, I think it's just a little too beta-y for me. But I know these guys love it, so take it away. Why do you guys love it? Let us know, anyone, Tim or Clowns. I know you guys have put the most time into it, so.
I think out of the four of us, Clowns should start.
All right, Clowns, go ahead. Tell us why you love it so much.
Just because it's awesome. That's all you need to know. It's awesome. That's it. Just get it. Don't even get the trial. Just buy it right away. Just buy it and play it. It's a survival type game, and that's where it's awesome. It does it right. I mean, you got to eat to live. You got to hunt stuff. You got to build stuff. You got to get wood. You got to get thatch. You got to get different types of berries. There's even narco berries. I mean, how ingenious is that? That's ingenious. I mean, you can take narco berries and make, like, narcotics to knock out the dinosaurs. And then you tame them by feeding them their favorite food. It cannot get better than that.
Those mechanics are just... The attention to detail in the mechanics is just borderline unmatched with this one. I think I agree on that. It's definitely AAA-like in that regard, 100%. But continue, Clown, sorry.
Inferno, I don't know if you saw the picture I posted, but... From the tribe that I'm in on a PvP server, mm-hmm. we already got like 4 T-Rexes and like 900 other dinosaurs in our 35-man tribe. And I'm the lowest one there, and I get to ride everything. It's so cool. Wow. They built like these huge, huge castle steel doors. And they have electricity inside our base. And they got like water coming into our base. We're on a cliff. And we got like I don't even know what they're called, but those lines or hoses out to the ocean, pulling in ocean water, and mm-hmm. we can get fresh water to drink, build crops, fly on whatever they call the pterodactyls. I always forget their name, but we get to fly in them, pick people up, and even drop them off the cliff if they don't belong in our base area. It is awesome. Mm-hmm. You can't do better than that, dude. You just can't do better than that.
I don't know how they put so much into the game, and yet it's only like... I don't know how big it is, even like 30 gigs. How big is it? Does anyone know off the top of their heads? I mean, it's not like how big. You'd think that a game of this scope would be like AAA in size, like 60 gigs, you know, for Halo Master Chief Collection or something like that. You'd think that it would take up a huge chunk of some people's limited hard drive space on their Xbox Ones, you know, 500 gigs with only like 360 of that or 380 of that usable, and you download a huge game and you're kind of crippled. But this game is actually not massive, I wouldn't say. How big is it, Assassin?
24.9 gigs,
and you can do all that stuff that Clowns just said. I mean, that's just amazing.
Yeah, I think it has to do with the fact that it is in beta, and I think right now, I don't know what type of engine they used. I forgot when I looked it up.
Unreal 4. Unreal 4? Yep. Yeah, sick.
I don't think they even pushed the graphics to the limits yet. I think, you know, what they did was they skinned what they wanted, put it in there. It's still in beta. And, I mean, they can always upgrade the graphics later, which would increase the size. But right now, even with the graphics it has, it's perfect for me. And Tim, you could take it away too. You love it as much as I do.
Yeah. This game took me by. I would never think that Ark would take me the way it did, and it's taken me. I'm gonna be playing it after we get off the podcast, and I'm planning my night around playing it and going to sleep, and I have to pick my daughter up tomorrow, so I have to go to sleep at 1. So, but I'm like, I have 3 hours to play this game or 2 hours, you know, that is what I'm going to do. And I haven't had that happen to me in a game for a long time. Mm-hmm. So, it is special to me in that regard. What is great about the game? You explained it well, Clowns. the community part is great. I go on chat with my tribe every night, and you know, whatever they're doing, what adventure they're on, whatever they're building. The game is expansive. It changes. The support, while it has definitely a bunch of issues, and it's rough around the edges, as somebody once told me, it's fun to play. It's real fun to play. Like, there's a social quality about it that I like. There's also the way you build up and you build your character. Like, I find myself, if I'm living for a long time, like, I get lost in this game. Wander off. Beard's usually yelling because I play with the beard. He's yelling at me because, you know, he puts people to task. Well, he doesn't put people to task. We do things as a tribe, and like, we'll get him wood and he'll build stuff. He's built an insane community. We all have houses there, except for me. I'm the caveman. They build a guest house for me. I just go out and wander, but I get lost in this game, and it's a special game. I'm going to say it right now. It is a special game, and it is going to get bigger because the dev, who's a Wildcard, I believe, is the dev, but I know it's run by – it used to be a big guy at Microsoft that's a former employee. Mm-hmm. So he knows what he's doing. This is not like some independent developer. This is somebody who understands infrastructure, and I'm very impressed. I don't know. I have a lot of questions. I asked Jake in a DM. He's the community. You guys are in the community. He hasn't answered me. But, like, what servers are they using? How are they handling this? Is there cloud computing this? I don't understand how you can have 5,000 animals, you know, on a map at any time in different locations. It really is something that everyone has to experience. You play it, you're going to either hate it and drop it in 20 minutes, but if you stick with it for about 2 hours, it ropes you in. And I'm totally roped in. Where it's to the point where I don't want to be this roped in because I don't want to really schedule my night always for a video game, even though I love video games. You know, sometimes right. I just want to watch a movie or watch the Mets game or watch Giants, Knicks, or whatever. But this game is, you know, this game has my wife is like, you're going downstairs. I'm like, yeah, I'm just like, you know, I had to take her out to dinner just to keep her happy. You know, I mean, like, I'm serious. I am like ridiculous. It kept me up till 5 a.m. And I was a walking zombie at work. I mean, I was like, I'm like, I was kind of like, I just need to get away from this game. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to play it tonight. I haven't played it in a couple of days because I went through that where it was just, it becomes too much. And I'm sure you guys who are playing it can understand. It just, you know, you lose like 2 hours is like, you goes how fast? 2 hours goes. You know, you look at the clock and you're like, I've already been playing this game for 2 hours, like nothing. I've never experienced this really with a game as a gamer my whole life where, you know, I've been, you know, roped in by Skyrim and loved that and was just, you know, playing. But this game just, you know, part of it's because of the social aspect. You know, you could just be, you know, talking to your tribe and hearing what they're doing. Beard was having negotiations with another tribe. They put flash mob sucks on our and this is PvE. So I can't imagine what PvP is. I mean, that is clowns. Could you play PvE or is it only PvP for you? Because you could be overtaken at any time. Correct.
Yep. Correct. I mean, you could be overtaken at any time of PvP, and I mean, and everything.
You can repel, like your whole thing can blow up, right? They can just take the. Yep. They can 60 group tribe can come in and destroy thousands of hours of work, construction, water, all the stuff that you talked about.
Wow.
That could happen. That's what Beard doesn't want to mess with that. Like, because right. We talk, like, you know, imagine that happened. Like, what do you do? Like, you everything is like completely destroyed that you just built and put these hours in, what would you do, clowns? Well, do you guys guard against that? Like, what is the PvP mentality?
Well, for our tribe, we're one of the, I guess, one of the larger sized tribes now. And we already have alliances with, like, three other large tribes. But we got into a war with a six-man tribe over some petty stuff. We accepted. And it's so petty, too, because it's a video game. But yeah. we accepted this one guy into our tribe. And all he wanted to do was create war. And he convinced some members of our tribe that a six-man tribe was going to take us on Christmas Eve and do, like, a George Washington attack on us and raid our stuff. So our 35-man tribe destroyed everything the six-man tribe made. And the six-man tribe, dude, they were good at sniping. They were snipers. That's what they did. Mm-hmm. So we were on a cliff, and they just sniped all our dinosaurs. Bam! Sniped them. Gone! So, but our crew members saved them. Our tribe members saved some. But, Tim, basically what we did was our tribe, they built, like, we got, I want to say, like, level 80s and 90s already, something like that. But they build these huge, huge walls and steel doors, and they surround the cliff with them, and then spikes on the outside of those, and then and here's the worst part. They put trick steel doors around. So, like, you can go into one steel door and knock on one door, and there's, like, five other doors, and you got to figure out which one leads to our conclave.
Wow.
Like, I got lost going back to my own base. Wow. I got lost. Yeah, it's insane, dude. And we got turrets up, too, that shoot acid. If you're not in our tribe, they destroy you. You fly over us, it's a no-fly zone.
I think this is why this game is doing well. Like, this time, like, what we're talking about right now is absolutely, you know, blowing my mind. Like, you really can have a 60... you can have somebody go to war with you and actually... I mean, it is a video game, so it's not real, but it's crazy, like, that you could be attacked. So, I mean, I want to play PvP, but I've just put so much time in PvE. And even PvE has its, like, share issues. Like I said, where Beard had to talk to, like, another tribe and, like, make peace. He actually was the diplomat.
Right.
And then they worked it out. He went on the thing. But that's where, you know, the game is just like, I never had that quality ever happen with me as a gamer. Like, that type of stuff. That's just new to me.
Go ahead, Klaus.
Tim, one thing that we just did the other day, because we squashed our differences with the six-man tribe. I had to act like a diplomat. It was really insane. Like, I had to come up with these social skills, and we had to go into parties and talk to other tribe leaders and bring other tribe leaders in and just talk about it. And what we came up with is this concept of, we're going to form like a United Nations, since we're one of the bigger tribes, and we're going to get all the other bigger tribes with us. And at the heads of the table of this United Nations will be like one tribe leader from each tribe, and then like one, I guess, like, you can call him vice president or whatever you want, with them for votes. And we're going to try to do a system where if a new tribe comes in town and they start messing around or invading airspace and no-fly zones, because we're going to have signs up to say no-fly zones, we'll actually, like, take votes. Are we going to destroy this tribe right now, or are we going to give them a peaceful chance? And we're going to set up a network of trades, too, like, so other tribes in the United Nations could trade with each other. Care packages if they're going to war.
Wow.
You know, we're running this thing like a real country. That's what we're doing.
That, you know, and that's where it's so crazy. And you're serious. Like, if somebody like that doesn't know video games actually listening to this, they probably I can imagine what they're thinking. But fact is, that you're serious and it actually happens. You know, and it's going to keep growing. So, I mean, it's, like I said, it just really took me by surprise.
Trust us, new viewers and listeners, we are not nuts at all.
Nope, absolutely not.
This is real stuff. This does happen. And we'll, you know, it's the scope of the game is amazing. And, you know, I, you know, for some people, I think the scope of it that you guys have been talking about, and that being only like a fraction of the stuff you can actually do in the game, I think that kind of might scare some people away. But, you know, this game is one where you make it as big or as small as you want it. You don't have to, you know, join these massive tribes or anything like that. If you want to, you know, be fairly successful, you probably should ally with some people.
We're accepting new tribe members. We're accepting, just putting it out there, we're accepting people.
Oh yeah, so
you're right though. You see, I like that's a good point that you bring up because I kind of am like a loner. Like I could be happy eating berries and having a little my private Idaho around, just built by myself. Like I could play this game single player. I mean, it's great with the social, but that it is true. You can make the, it is as big as you want or as small as you want. You could just be a caveman eating berries, you know, running away. It's one to be experienced.
That's actually been my experience with the game so far.
I want to throw in one other thing real quick before I forget. With our tribe, well, we had to kick this dude out to make peace with like three other tribes because of that war that started, whatnot. So we were going to hand him over to the other tribe before he ran away. And here was the sick plan behind this, and this is horrible that people can do this in this game, but it's so creative. They were going to take him, knock him out, right, and force feed him narcotics and keep him in a suspended state so he could not respawn. And wow. They were going to build a cage in the middle of the ocean. Just in case he got away, he would have been surrounded by like megalodons and crocodiles and stuff. So, I mean, like, they put this whole plan into motion of how he was going to be treated for his betrayal. I was like, wow, this is nuts.
Yeah, that is when you play with the group, and I know that the tribe works together. Like, they're, you know, like I'm a hunter and gatherer, I'll bring back the stuff. Like, you know, there is a greater cause. And there are leaders and everything falls in its place, just kind of like if you were surviving out in the nature, which is it's interesting too, you know. And I could, you know, like again, these are the types of things that happen if, you know, everyone's talking and the tribes are talking about this person who's making a problem. They will do that stuff, and laugh about it, but they will do it.
Right.
Yeah, and in PvP, you can't get out of that once you're tranquilized because they can keep force feeding you.
Yeah, just like they do to team the
right,
animals.
Yep. Right, right. Assassin, I know you've put some time into Ark and haven't really said anything. You want to offer your opinion?
Well, first, Clowns, you should tell them the story of the guy that had some like weird dungeon that he would put people that were knocked out, and then
you would, oh, you know, yes.
That sounds creepy.
I'll add that in. So, Tim, I get back from Christmas break because I was like on a little Christmas break. I didn't play for like 5 days and whatnot. Okay. So I get back, I get on, and I spawn at my tribal base because that's where my unconscious body is. Well, I didn't know about this war that happened, and I was in party chat with like my other friends, not my tribe friends, but my other friends. And there were tribe members on that I didn't know because we have, you know, a pretty large tribe. Mm-hmm. So I'm locked in this little room where they dragged my body. And they, like, I don't know what they did, but they locked the door on me and put me in this little room because they didn't know who I was because my name was Bob. And the tribe leader wasn't on to explain who Bob was because I never changed my name.
Right.
And he opens the door and he starts speaking, like, in the chat. I didn't say anything because I'm in party chat, not in game chat. So then he locks me in there for like another hour. Then he opens the door and he lets me out. So I walk out. Next thing I know, they set turrets up just to kill me. They just moved them over there just to shoot me as soon as I walked out of the door. And then they stole my armor. And this was my own tribe. And they were scared because of the war and they didn't know who I was.
Wow. That's intense.
Oh, man. Yeah, and J Street in the chat is saying essentially that this game sounds pretty intense. He says, sounds a little too deep and real. Seriously, some of the stuff we're saying is crazy. And I mean, yeah, I mean, it's true. Yeah, we sound like nuts, I'm not going to lie. But I mean, It's one of those games where it sounds nuts, but you get into it, and you're going to be nuts soon, too, man. You're going to be nuts soon, too. So, Assassin, do you have any other thoughts other than Clown's story?
Yeah, I mean, the game is a lot of fun. I didn't put as many hours as, you know, Clowns here, but it's just fun walking around, and then you get these little stupid dinosaurs. Remember, like, Jurassic Park 3, where this little girl had, like, a fucking sandwich, and they all attack her. That always is me. I'm that little girl getting destroyed by these little tiny dinosaurs.
Everyone else is worrying about, like, other people and T-Rexes and everything. You're just right there, like, get away from me, you little dinosaurs.
Right.
They come in packs.
Yeah, man. I mean, I got to get more into it. I got to dedicate some time to it, get my feet wet. You know, I mean, I'm obviously going to buy it. How can I not? You know what I mean? It's what people thought H1Z1 was going to be for consoles. And when people saw some of these MMOs come to console, and they were like, oh, it's going to take over, it's going to be super successful, you know, this stuff is so popular now, and now, you know, Arx and Game Preview for Xbox, it's coming to both PlayStation and Xbox in you know, 6 months or so, 7 months. You know, this is gonna be one of those games that everyone talks about and plays, and if you're gonna be, I think it's going to be one of those games that if you want to be a serious kind of gamer, then you're going to at least have to put some time into it. So, I mean, and it's in game preview right now. You can get the whole thing, you know, for $35, or is that what it is?
35? Yeah, 35.
So, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's to get a AAA kind of experience, or even better than, as we've been saying here, like, these guys think this is even better than AAA. Kind of experience out of a game that only costs $35. I think, you know, why not, right?
Why not? You know, I've enjoyed my time with the game from what I've played of it, but my biggest complaint is it has to do with the graphics, but not the graphics themselves. Like, I don't mind the graphic quality, it's just I want more draw distance.
Oh yeah, dude. I 100% agree. And I know I was kind of saying, like, it's nice that you can get a game of this scope that's only 25 gigs before, but if you had to make it 50 gigs just to give me, like, you know, way more draw distance and a little sharper textures, I'm taking it every day of the week.
I mean, even to me, the textures are fine on most objects, but, like, I just want more draw distance because, like, whenever I played with Clowns and Assassin, whenever the game first released on Xbox, we set up these torches along a beach to find our way back while we went to explore, like, to find our way back to the base. Well, because of draw distance, it was kind of hard and difficult to find those torches and follow them.
Right.
Unless we placed them, like, really close together.
Right, right. No, I agree with you. That's one of the big things that is kind of holding me back a little bit is, you know, is that draw distance. I agree with you. I think that's what makes it, that's one of the big things for me that makes it still feel too much in beta for me to buy it at this very moment. But I am encouraged by, you know, the feedback it's receiving and how dedicated that we know the development team is to you know, improve it. I definitely expect to see this be a real kind of game preview game. You know, some of the game preview games, you can argue, you're like, no one gives feedback, you know, nothing's really improved. You know, you've had some game preview games that have been out for a little while and nothing has really happened to them. But this one, I think, is going to be one where you're going to see, you know, improvements that you expect out of the Xbox preview program for the dashboard. You'll see the same out of this game for game preview. I think we're due for a game to really make that kind of thing shine, where beta testing is really, like, helpful towards making a game incredible.
Yeah, and Inferno, I just want to let you know that if you do buy the game, which you're contemplating, you don't have to worry about leveling up. Well, I mean, we'll take care of you. We actually have control of an island where dinosaurs spawn. We got, like, 9 rafts around it and spikes around it, and we control it. So you could take our T-Rex over there and jump from, like, 1 to 50 in no time.
Wow. And is that the level cap, 50?
No, it goes higher than that.
Oh, does it? Okay. Is there a level cap? Is there one?
I don't know. It's a good question.
Yeah. I heard rumors that it's like around 120.
Yeah. It gets really hard though, right? Like one, like when you hit, as you go up, like when you hit one and two, those are real quick. But like when you, even when you hit like 30 to 30, like five, it seems like you have to do a lot more stuff than what you used to be able to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can only imagine like being 70 to 71. You know, you have to probably, I mean, Beard's put in over 150 hours, maybe. I mean, ridiculous amount of time, and he's only a 45. So
right.
Tim, real quick, do you guys have like T-Rexes on your? And your tribe?
No, we haven't tamed a T-Rex. Right now, Beard is he's pretty much, like I said, the tribe leader. He's he builds everything. He's getting metal. He got a Aqua. I don't know the one where you can. It has all the spikes on it. An Ankyo Thesaurus or something. I don't know the correct name, but he got that. We have a bunch of raptors. I've seen the T-Rexes tamed in their dinosaur thing. We haven't done that. He's basically building another settlement around the arcs. What's really cool about this game is that there's these arcs where there's like these things that, you know, that are mythical, and they're big shining blue, red, and green. And in the arc, you can actually summon the boss, and you put you find artifacts and caves and stuff like that, and you need like 8 T-Rex arms, all these requirements to summon the boss of that arc, and you actually fight it. So there's so much to this game, but he's basically, we're expanding, building out. We like have about 10 houses in the community where he is. It's all, you know, sectioned off, and now he's doing, he likes to build. He likes to construct, like, you know, that's what he does, I think, for his living, or he did his construction. Right. So he loves to just build. So we have not we've tamed about everything. We have a Carno. We have the ducks. What are they called? The doves for eggs.
Yeah. Yep. You know, I know what you're talking about. I can't think of the name.
Dodo bird. We have the dodo birds tamed. We have a flock of them. I mean, it's you know, he does it in a nice way. He's not like geared up for the war. Like, I know he didn't want that. He likes to build. So he likes to tame too, but we have not got the T-Rex. I mean, that, you know, for me, I like to go hunting. Mm-hmm. But basically, a lot of the times, you know, they're onto something, doing something, expanding land, or, you know, venturing onto something to get high. I mean, he has, like, there's, like, literally about 50 tamed animals, and you have to feed these animals. So you have to go on these runs to get meat.
Right.
So, you know, we actually go on runs to get meat and hide. Raw meat, and we feed the animals, and we have to do that. Like, it's like a family. It's developed into something that I don't know where it's going to take us next. But I would like to definitely tame a T-Rex.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know. Well, I will tell you that when you guys tame a T-Rex and you take it out there to like destroy other dinosaurs, you're going to jump in level dramatically, and everything that the T-Rex eats or destroys, it saves its like meat and all that on its body, so you could just take it right off and feed your other dinosaurs.
Wow, I'm gonna tell Beard that we're gonna probably do. He probably, I don't know, I haven't played in 2 nights, so he probably has a T-Rex. But yeah, that's the things that you learn about the game that are so cool. Like, I've seen somebody riding a saber-tooth tiger. I heard that you can you can tame a megalodon and that type of stuff, and there's a underwater cave. I mean, the game is just, it's getting ridiculously out of here. You know, there's an Antarctica portion of it where you have to put on, have you been to that, the expansion pack or whatever that is, where you can get the mammoth elephant?
Yep, I believe they spawn up in the north zone where it's snowing. I want to say that's where I've seen them. But our tribe, when I log back on, they actually got Woolly Mammoths already.
They do?
Yeah, we got Sabertooths. We got the Crocodiles also. And they already boosted it so that it runs fast on land.
Now, you can't, like the cool thing about the game is everything's so balanced. Like, you can't go to the north where it's snowing and just have, like, metal armor. You actually have to have fur armor, like, mm-hmm. just like you would have to bulk up if you went to Alaska. So, and then to get the fur armor, you have to get all these materials to build the armor. So, you have to go hunting, and to get, like, your armor to go up there might take 6 hours. And then the next day you're on to going up north and, you know, getting penguins and doing all the stuff that they're adding. And they're just going to keep adding. There's just going to be – that's the thing. They could just keep adding. So it's interesting.
All right. We could be talking all night about this Ark thing, but
– such a great game.
I think we are out of time here, and this dog is back. He's going to make a lot of noise. I had somebody watching the dog for a little bit while we recorded the podcast, but now that she's back, I think we got to wrap it up so there isn't a lot of barking. But Tim, thank you so much for joining us tonight on the
show. Thank you. It was great.
Tell us, you know, where we can find you on the interwebs.
You can find me on Twitter, TIM/DOG. I go on a lot of podcasts, so I'm not going to go through all of them, but you could just pretty much, I'll when I go on the podcast, I usually retweet it. So just follow me on Twitter. If you like what you heard, you know, it's pretty fun. My Twitter, I try to make it fun at least. And thank you guys. Every one of you, very nice guys. The show is great. I'm going to be definitely tuning in, from this point forward.
Awesome, Tim. Yeah, thank you for the support. We really appreciate it. And everyone else wants to check up on our old episodes, you can find us on YouTube, youtube.com/4guyswithquarters. You can also find us those episodes on our website, 4guyswithquarters.com. The Clowns is redesigning for the new year. Thank you, Clowns, for all your hard work. Also, find us on social media, 4guyswithquarters on Facebook, and on Twitter, 4GWQ podcast. And if you want to get in touch with us individually, which we highly encourage you do, check out our handles that have been cycling below our pictures for the entire show. So you can get in touch with us on Twitch, Twitter, Xbox, all those things. So, yeah, it's the end of the show. Sorry it went over, but, I mean, Ark is a hot topic, and we know Tim loves to talk Xbox, so we're kind of glad we were able to, you know, fill the whole show and get her done. So thank you guys for coming by. Next show will be probably next Thursday, and it'll be the new year. So new year, new us. So let's see what happens. See you guys later.
Peace. Bye.